All right. Well, hey, Merry Christmas. It is hard to believe that Christmas is here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, crazy. And, you know, I thought, you know, what better way to kind of help us maybe kind of get into the Christmas spirit of things than something kind of giving you the gift that honestly a lot of people have been asking me about and asking me to do, which is singing some songs.
Literally nobody in the world has asked you to do that in the past 7 years.
Regardless. Anyway, I thought it'd be fun to do a little bit of Christmas karaoke.
This is your part. Oh, why Christmas, with every Christmas card I write, may your days be merry and bright, and may all your Christmas.
This is your part.
Dreaming of a white Christmas, just like the ones I used to know. Treetops glisten and sleigh bells in the snow.
Why'd you go from high to low?
Repeat the sound. Welcome, and thank you for joining us for our candlelight service. My name is Jeremy, and I'm an associate pastor here at Newport Foursquare. I just want to thank you for giving us your time and sharing this fellowship with us. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. We have a candlelight service coming up after the message, so please be ready for that. But maybe, just maybe, you're in a place where candles aren't necessarily a viable option. Maybe the weather's terrible, or maybe it's just not safe. Well, I have an assistant coming up. This is Austin, my Christmas helper. And we just have some alternative solutions that can help you this season. First, we have a wonderful battery-operated candle. Maybe that's something that's more your speed. We also have a wonderful camping lantern. Maybe that can help you. Or just some good old-fashioned Christmas lights. And last, but certainly not least, a light-up saber. Now remember, our candlelight service is coming up after the message, so please, please be ready with whatever options you have available to you. Thank you, and Merry Christmas.
Star is shining in the sky. Below Hallelujah.
Hey, Merry Christmas. So glad to have you joining with us to celebrate really the greatest gift the world has ever known. This gift of Emmanuel, this gift of God with us, this gift of Jesus. A gift that we find in Luke 2 brings with it a good news that will cause great joy for all. Because today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He's the Messiah. He's the Lord. And then going down to verse 14, I like how it puts this: as glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those whom His favor rests. You know, when I think of some of my favorite things about Christmas, I think of the peppermint mochas. I think of maybe binge watching some Home Alone and It's a Wonderful Life. I also think about the Hallmark countdown to Christmas that feels like it began back in August and it's finally coming to an end, right? But more recently, I've added a new item to the list of a few of my favorite things around Christmas, and that is Christmas memes. Christmas memes. In fact, I thought it'd be fun to share just a few of my favorites with you tonight. The first one being this: that if there were some wise men who showed up on the scene, maybe it's not totally out of the realm of possibility that there were also some wise women who eventually show up as well. Let's check this out. After the three wise men left, three wiser women show up bringing fresh diapers, casseroles for the week, and lots of baby formula, right? All the moms and grandmas just said amen, right? I mean, in some ways, it almost seems like it makes a little more sense than some frankincense and myrrh. Or how about this one? Mary, exhausted, having just gotten Jesus asleep, is approached by a young man who thinks to himself, what this girl needs is a drum solo. By the way, this is how we know some of our Christmas carols just don't always make very much sense. Because any mom knows that, but if that really happened, I'm pretty sure you know Mary would have tried to cut him. Because while Jesus was the perfect, sinless, spotless Lamb of God, Mary was not. Mary would have been your typical overprotective mama bear. Which brings us to this last one. That while not biblical in any way, is still pretty accurate, at least within our household. As the baby Yoda on the left is really every mom watching you open presents Christmas morning, and the baby Yoda on the right is every dad who's just as surprised as you are in seeing what it is. As listen, and speaking of a few of our favorite things about Christmas, it started getting me thinking about a few of God's favorite things. Because part of what I think makes Christmas such good news, a great joy for all, isn't just this news that God is with us, but that God is for us as well. And in fact, that's really what we're talking about when we talk about the favor of God. And a favor that, might I add, we don't always find where we might expect to find it. Let's check out how the Christmas story starts out in Luke chapter 1, starting verse 26. It says, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, greetings, favored woman. The Lord is with you. Confused and disturbed, and Mary tried to think, what could this angel mean? Don't be afraid, Mary, the angels told her, for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. Jesus, which literally actually means one who saves. One who saves. Now, one of the things I find so interesting about Mary's response to this angel showing up with this life-changing news is not that she was afraid. Like that was to be expected. Can we all agree? As I don't know anybody who wouldn't have been a little more, at least a little terrified at the sight of this angelic presence in front of them. Especially given how the angel starts off this conversation. Telling Mary, hey, don't be afraid.
Now, I don't know about you, but whenever somebody starts off something with, hey, don't be afraid. Look, if I wasn't afraid before, worried before, safe to say I am now. Like nobody, when they're flying on a plane, wants to hear the pilot get on the intercom, only to start off by saying, hey, don't be afraid. Because I hear that and I'm instantly imagining worst case scenario. I'm thinking back to all those episodes of air disasters. I find Austin always watching on TV. So the fact that Mary was afraid is not surprising. And again, all things considered, to be expected. No, what is surprising though, is when she was afraid, when she was troubled, when she was disturbed. As it doesn't say that she's afraid and troubled when all of a sudden an angel appeared out of nowhere. She's also not afraid or troubled, interesting enough, at the thought of having to share this news with Joseph, which I kind of think would have been absolutely terrifying, wouldn't it? Like, Joseph, hey, you might want to sit down for this. Because surprise, you're going to be a dad. And I know what you're thinking, but don't worry, it's not what you think, but rather this is a miracle of God. It doesn't even say she's afraid when it comes time to give birth. Even when she has to take this last minute road trip with Joseph to Bethlehem. Only to, when she gets there, find no hospital, no anesthesiologist, and not even a proper room to give birth in, but rather a manger. No, let's look at it again. In Luke 1, 28 through 29, notice when it says that Mary started to feel afraid, troubled, overwhelmed. It says the angel went to her and said, greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. The Lord is with you. Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. In other words, what Mary struggled most to wrap her mind around was not this angelic presence, but rather what was most alarming and troubling to Mary were the words, greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you. See, something you've got to understand about this good news of great joy is that while it was good news, it wasn't breaking news. And like the idea of Emmanuel, of a God who's with us, wasn't breaking news to the Jewish people. As they understood and they knew that God is with us. But rather than seeing it for what it is, that God is with us, period. Their understanding would have been God is with us, only to follow that up with a whole bunch of fine print and exclusions to that. Because for them, they only believed that God was with the special people, the gifted people, the uber religious people, the important people, the put together people, the got life all figured out kind of people. And so to hear this angel say, God is with us, wouldn't have been anything new to Mary. But what was new, what was overwhelming to her, was the angel showing up to tell Mary that God is with you, Mary. God is with you. God is with ordinary, overlooked, humble beginnings, you, Mary. In fact, it might help to explain why we see her at first responding to this news the way she does. Going on to say this in verse 34, but how can this be? How can this be? Like that's great news and all, but pretty sure you got the wrong girl here. Because I don't know if you know this or not, but I have not done what would need to be done to biologically make this happen. And it's here that Mary would come to discover something about God's favor that we got to get, especially if we hope to receive this gift of Jesus and all the freedom and all the joy and all the life that comes with that. And that's by understanding that we don't find favor because of what we do for God, but because of who we are to God. You know, not all that long ago, Holly and I invited someone into to live in our home who needed a home. And to be perfectly honest, while up to this point, it's actually worked out pretty great for everyone. That's not to say it hasn't also had its times of challenges. Like, we don't make this person pay any rent. This person has very few chores or responsibilities that we ask of them. This person even eats all of our food, rarely volunteering to cook or to clean. And because they don't have a driver's license, a lot of times we get stuck basically being their Uber driver, shuttling them around town, especially at all of his school basketball and football games and events. Now, here's the thing. How many of you, before you figured out that I was talking about my son, Austin, thought to yourself, why would anybody agree to that? Like, it sounds crazy just on paper, doesn't it? It sounds like a terrible deal on paper. And yet, isn't it interesting that the moment you figured out that I was talking about my son, how many of you were like, oh, now I get it. I get it now, because, of course, that's what you do as a parent. That's what you do for your kids. That's what you do for those you care about, those you love. And in fact, again, might help to explain why the angel starts this pronouncement off the way that he does. In verse 32, it's almost as if he knows the questions are going to be swirling around in Mary's mind. And so he starts off by saying this. He says, he will be very great. Speaking of Jesus, he says, he will be very great and be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever, for his kingdom will never end. Now, at first glance, this might not seem like that big of a deal, until you realize this question Mary asks, it wasn't simply just about the biology of it, but it was about her identity in it. As maybe the best way to kind of explain where I'm going with this is by moving, taking a little trek over to this account of the Christmas story, and really in reference to this very statement that is made in Luke that we actually find in Matthew's. Matthew's account of the Christmas story, this one that adds more details to the statement that the angel makes back in Luke. And it's this interesting kind of account. It's sort of the account of the Christmas story that, let's be real, nobody reads outside of maybe that crazy uncle who's way too into Ancestry.com. Now, this is the account of the Christmas story we find in Matthew 1. You know, the part of the story most of us just tend to click to the skip to next episode button on. And this is how it begins. Matthew 1, starting in verse 1, says, this is the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah, and his brothers, Judah the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar, Perez the father of Hezron, Hezron the father of Ram. As probably about now, you're discovering why Linus chose to read Luke's account of the Christmas story instead of Matthew's. Skipping all the way down to this list of verse 16 says, and Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, and Mary was the mother of Jesus, who was called the Messiah. Thus there were 14 generations in all, from Abraham to David, 14 from David to the exile to Babylon, and 14 from the exile to the Messiah. Like, of all the ways, Matthew, you could think of starting off by telling the most compelling story in all of human history. Like, why start off with the credits? Listing out name after name associated with the genealogy of this coming Messiah, this Messiah in Jesus. And I think part of the reason is to make it clear that this is not just some once upon a time kind of story. It's not a fable. It's not a myth. It's not even a great novel or a great kid's story. But rather, the Christmas story is one that involves some very real people. With, might I add, people who had some real issues and real messiness and real struggles in their lives. As I don't know if you've ever heard this saying before, maybe you've even said it before at one point in your life, but it's a statement that you can't choose your family. And look, while that may be very true of you and very true of me, how many know that the one person in this world that wouldn't have been true for was Jesus? Jesus, because Jesus existed before his family. In fact, Jesus existed even before there were families, before this world had taken shape, as the Bible talks about how Jesus intrinsically had his hands involved in the very creation of this world. Which, when you think about it, is, again, getting back to this, is pretty powerful. I mean, that he got to choose the family he was from. Jesus chose who he came from, who he was associated ultimately with, which is a pretty powerful truth, especially when you see who it is exactly that Jesus chose to come from. As going back to this list of names Matthew shares, we see him opening it up with some names that certainly the religious of the day would have expected the Messiah to come from. Like David, this man after God's own heart. Yeah, check, I get that. Who we see taking down Goliath, becoming one of the greatest kings in the history of Israel. Makes sense to me that he would be on the list. You also got names like Abraham. Yeah, check, that's another one. Very father of the Jewish faith, right? Again, no shockers. When it comes to names you'd expect to find when it came to the history and the family roots, one might expect the Messiah to come from. That is until you get to verse 3. When it says this, as Judah, the father of Perez, Zerah, whose mother was Tamar. And this is where eyebrows would have started to have been raised to those hearing this for the first time. As in most ancient genealogies, during this time, it was incredibly rare to list women or the mom within the family tree. And in the rare cases where you'd find a woman listed within Jewish genealogy, it was always in reference to some of the great matriarchs and great women of the faith, like Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah. Like those are the kind of people and names they would have been expecting to find the Messiah connected to. Only for Matthew, to the surprise of everyone, starting it off with someone like Tamar. Now, if you're unfamiliar with Tamar's story, we find it in Genesis 38. And let's just say, if you've ever felt like you've made some questionable relationship choices in your life, you need to know you're not alone. As maybe the best way to describe Tamar's life is like this cross between a Dateline episode and a Maury Povich show. Like as all the way back in Genesis, we first see her marrying Judah's son, Ur. Which just a side note, come on, Judah. I think we could probably do a little bit better when it comes to baby names than Ur. Ur. Actually, it reminds me of back when, before Holly and I were married, we had some Bible college classes together. And I remember one of her friends leaning over and asking her, hey, do you ever see yourself dating a guy like Seth? And her response, kid you not, was, date him. I can't even understand him. Right? Because before I have a cup of coffee, it's like he just mumbles all the time. And so maybe in Judah's defense, he was a mumbler like me before that morning cup of coffee. But right? Because of his bad boy lifestyle, this is who Tamar marries, ends up, because of what the Bible describes as his wickedness, through his own poor choice and poor decision after poor decision, ultimately dies. And that's interesting enough. This happens actually a couple more times after this, with Tamar finding herself in relationship with somebody who ends up dying because of their own self-destructive decisions, eventually marrying Judah. That's right. The same Judah whose son was Ur. As this is where the reality TV show part comes into play. Like you thought you had some like relational dysfunction in your family. I can assure you it does not compare to Tamar's. And of course, if a name like Tamar didn't get their attention, as you just read through this list, that certainly some of the other names would have. Like names like Rahab, who, let's just say, when we first read of her story in the book of Joshua, we see her doing a job that, let's just say, no girl when they're little ever imagines or hopes to find themselves in. Trapped in a life and a lifestyle she had to have felt like there was little, if any, hope of getting out of. And look, it's not just with some of the ladies. We see, again, another reference to David, but as opposed to referencing sort of the high mark moments of David's life. This, you know, this king of Israel, this, you know, slayer of giants in taking down Goliath. We see this reference to maybe the lowest point in David's life, where in a moment of compromise, ends up losing it all. In a moment of failure, in a moment of poor decisions. So, and here's why I bring this. So why share these names? Because again, you just go throughout this, you just see name after name of messy situation after messy situation. And it's like, well, why didn't Matthew feel like it was so necessary to include all of these names? And not just the ones who had it all together, but even the ones who had some serious mess and issues and dysfunction in their life. Well, why did he go out of his way to make sure we knew the family line in which Jesus would come from? Well, you can kind of think of it like this. This is actually the first year I actually took the time to write out name tags for everyone's gifts. Because in previous years, I just figured I'd remember whose gift was for who when the time came. Only to get to Christmas morning, and let's just say, whenever Austin or Holly would open up a gift, I was just like that Christmas meme, a baby Yoda I shared earlier, who was just as surprised to find out what they were opening up as they were. As Austin would open up like a collection of Hallmark movies and be like, gee, thanks, Dad. But not this year. Not this year. This year, I changed my strategy. This year, I wanted to make sure there was no doubt about who each gift was for. And so I put the names on the tag so there would be no doubt as to who this gift was for. See, here's what I'm trying to get us to see is why did Jesus connect himself or associate himself with names and people often identified with brokenness, identified with a failure, identified with bitterness, identified with disappointment? Why roll the credits when it came to the Christmas story right up at top? Here's why. I believe it's because seeing who Jesus chose to come from shows us who Jesus chose to come for. Seeing who Jesus chose to come from shows us who Jesus chose to come for. People with a past, people who can't stay out of their own way, people whose lives maybe feel like a mixed bag. Yeah, I got some good decisions over here, but I also got a whole lot of regrets over here. People who feel maybe overlooked or unseen or unnoticed like Mary. People just like you and just like me, real people. With real issues and real fears and real setbacks, because God wanted to leave no doubt through this story of Christmas that you are who he chose to come for, because catch this, you are one of God's most favorite things in the world. You are one of God's most favorite things in the world. And listen, don't take my word for it, take his. In fact, one of the most favorite, even if you've never been in church much, you know this Bible verse. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Going on in the next verse to say this, for God did not come to condemn the world but to save it. As truth is, Jesus didn't come to shame you. He came to save you, to save us from our sin, to save us from ourselves, to save us from more than just going through the motions of this life, by offering us his gift that can't be bought or earned or worked for. It can only be received. It's why it's interesting that the angels, in announcing the birth of Jesus to the shepherds back in Luke 2, were in describing this good news of great joy for all, going to say, peace on whom his favor rests. His favor rests, because again, you can't work for it, you can't earn it. It's simply a free gift. In fact, this word favor, that's actually what it means. It comes from this Greek word charis, which can literally be interpreted as a free gift, or catch this, grace upon grace. And look, here's why this matters. Is that when we talk about this gift or relationship with Jesus and the joy and the freedom and the hope and the life that it brings, do you know the only ones who never receive it are the ones who think that somehow this gift is not for them? Because either they think they're too far gone to receive it, or they think they're good enough without it. In fact, I tell you, that's why Jesus seems like he's always kind of getting into it with the Pharisees and the religious elites of the day, because they thought, oh, we deserve it, we earned it, or our righteous deeds, we've kept the law. It was a self-righteous, entitled attitude. Which, by the way, how many know nothing kills the Christmas spirit in a room than an entitled kid, right? But the way you receive favor, specifically the favor of God, and this gift of Emmanuel, this gift of Jesus, this gift of salvation, is by acknowledging, I didn't do what I needed to do to get what God wanted to give me, but he gave it to me anyway. I didn't do it, but he did it, and so I get it and receive it, and as a result, I'm grateful for it. And look, I get the pushback with this. Like that's great, Pastor, but what am I supposed to do with that? Especially when I've received the gift of Jesus, and yet I don't maybe feel very favored in this moment. And this is what I love about Mary's story. As we see God's favor not just showing up to some unlikely people, but also showing up in some pretty unlikely places. Because even though Mary finds favor with God, that doesn't mean that she finds herself in a favorable circumstance. As let's be honest, it's easy to believe that God is for me when my life is good. Or God is for me because things are working out how I thought they would work out. Or God is for me because I got that front row parking spot at Freddy's. Like, man, favor, right? Or God is for me because things are going my way. But what we find through Mary's story is that sometimes God's favor isn't found when everything's going your way, but when it seems like nothing is going your way. As we see Mary finding favor of, in all places, Bethlehem. This place that, mind you, she didn't plan on being. This place she didn't choose or want to be. This place she got dragged to because of this government census of the day that she didn't sign up for. And sometimes I think that whenever we, think of Bethlehem or sing songs, O Little Town of Bethlehem, if we're not careful, it can be easy to have this picture in our minds of, again, something from like a Hallmark movie. But the truth is, there was very little about Bethlehem that would have been seen to be very romantic or attractive in that day. As the reality is, the only people in Bethlehem were the people who had to be in Bethlehem. As this was a town that everyone, those who grew up in, always dreamed of someday getting away from, only because of this census of King Herod's during that time forced them to return back to. Finding not quaint little bakeries or Christmas tree farms, but no room anywhere to stay, except in this noisy, smelly barn. As it leads to this question again of how do we find favor in places that aren't favorable. And this is what I love about Mary's story and the faith that she had, the confidence that she had, because she found favor in an unfavorable situation. And here's how she did it. Check this out, Luke chapter 2, verse 19. This is after the birth. This is after the shepherds. This is after all the eggnogs run out. The lights have all come down. It says this in verse 19, but Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. Because let's be honest, it's easy to treasure the good things, isn't it? It's easy to value that which seems valuable. It's easy to appreciate that which seems worth celebrating. But Mary doesn't just treasure the good. It says she treasured all these things. All these things. Yeah, sure. She treasured the moments of holding 8-pound, 6-ounce baby Jesus in her arms. No doubt she treasured those moments when the angels showed to remind her that, hey, God is with you, God is for you. She treasured the times the shepherds and the wise men showed up. But what I love about this verse, it doesn't just say she treasured the good times, but it says she treasured it all. In other words, that means she found value even through the trial. She found value even through the waiting. She found value even in the struggles. She found favor in some unfavorable situations and circumstances. She found favor in some things that she went through that while she might not have ever chosen, she would never change when she thinks of what came out of that trial. when she thinks about what came out of that struggle. And as a result, comes to discover how some of God's very best gifts are actually often found in the very worst wrapping. See, Mary was favored because she found favor. And she found favor because she knew where to look. She found favor because no matter where she went, she knew that favor at the end of the day, it's not about what's going on around me, it's about what God has done and is doing in me. So as a result, Mary was able to walk into Bethlehem, that Bethlehem, backwoods, backwater Bethlehem, into this unfavorable place. She's able to walk in the confidence of God's favor on her life. Because she understood the favor is not out there. The favor is right in here. That because of Emmanuel, because of this gift of a God who's with us, not just a God who's with us, but a God who's also for us, even when it seems like everything is against us, I can still walk in the confidence and joy of knowing that I bring the blessing with me. I bring and I carry the favor with me. Because again, favor isn't about where you are as much as it's about who is with you. And the good news about this is that means that you can find God's favor because of Emmanuel anywhere you go. Anywhere you go. And look, I think it's important for some of us here because I wonder how many of us always feel like we got to get to another place or get to another season. Like if I can get through this or get past this, then I can find favor in a more favorable situation. In fact, I wonder if the very thing that's holding you back from receiving, I'm telling you, the greatest gift you could possibly receive and open up this Christmas, this gift of a relationship with Jesus, is this right here. It's because you thought the only way you could experience God's favor is maybe when you got to a more favorable situation or place in your life. After you got your act together a little bit. Like maybe after a few months, after you get the New Year's version of yourself. Like, man, I can see why God would bless like the New Year's version of me. After I've, you know, checked off a few New Year's resolutions, shown up to church a few times, I've, you know, taken some time to get alone with them, like after I've done a few things. But me right now, me before New Year's version of me, I don't know. But what I love about Mary's story and this amazing gift that can't be bought, can't be earned, it can only be received because of His amazing grace and His amazing mercy is that this favor that He offers you and me today is not something you got to wait till you get it all together before you can receive it. But you can receive it, you can open it up, you can experience it right now, right here, today. And if that's you, again, if you want to open up the greatest gift I'm telling you you could possibly open up this Christmas, but by stepping into a relationship with Jesus, listen, if that's you, I want to invite you to do just that by praying this prayer with me. In your heart, just sitting there saying, God, I recognize I've messed up more than a few times. I have sinned, and yet I believe in a God who loved me enough to leave heaven, to come to earth, to die on a cross, to pay a price in full for all my sin, shame, past, present, and future. And because of that, God, I ask you right now to come into my life, to be the Lord and Savior of my life. As I'm choosing right now to put you on the throne of my life and take a first step into this life that's found only through you, Jesus. Life eternal, life abundant, kind of life that's found only in you, Jesus. Give it all over to you. In Jesus' name, amen. And, you know, I can't think of a better way to sort of wrap up this time together than just through one more time just coming together in worship and just saying thank you. Thank you, God, for the greatest gift that I could possibly receive this Christmas, this gift of a relationship with you, Jesus, and all the joy and all the freedom and all the life that brings. And again, I love the kind of the candle lighting aspect to this, because and the candles is really symbolic of really John's accounts of the Christmas story, where he describes this light coming into a darkened world. And look, how many of you know that in the world we live in right now, we live in a world that could use a little bit of light, couldn't it? And as a result, when we think about this light of his grace and the light of the favor that he's shown us, the goodness he's shown us, how can we not reflect that same light in the world around, into a world that so desperately needs to be reminded of God's goodness and God's grace and his heart and his love and his mercy for them? And so right now we're going to sing Silent Night, and I invite you, wherever you're joining us from, wherever you're watching this from, maybe you don't have a candle, maybe you just got a phone light, hey, whatever you got that can produce some light, I encourage you, man, just shine that light as, again, a reminder to really live out what God has blessed you and me with through this gift of Jesus into this world as we sing together Silent Night.
Hey, thank you for joining us today. It was a lot of fun, wasn't it? Right now, we want to take some next steps with you. If you made a choice for Christ, we want to celebrate with you. I want to encourage you to go to the bottom of the screen and follow the link and fill out the information. We want to connect with you, send you a Bible and a coffee mug, and just celebrate this great thing. I also want to encourage you to join us for our in-person services, 5 o'clock on Saturdays in Newport, and at 9 and 10:30 a.m. on Sundays at our Walport location. God bless you, and have a wonderful day.